Save me a seat.
He said I passed you. I didn't even see you when I came in.
Yeah, you were in the lounge.
Oh,
Carolyn, yeah. Once you came in.
We're getting our last minute practice here.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for worship. We're not on. There's no way I can turn. Oh, there we are. All right. Thank you for joining us for worship today. We're going to wait just a minute or two because we need to get the microphone set up for Jeff and Carolyn. We thank them for being our musical leaders today. The main announcement is that our annual meeting is immediately after the service. Please don't leave, because I think we're like right at a quorum right now, so nobody's allowed to leave after me. You can all stay. I was joking, I'll confirm Winnie right now if we need one more person. Couple other announcements in the worship today. Notice when we sing the Kyrie, we're going to do it the way we did it a couple of weeks ago.
This is the feast.
I'm sorry, not the Kyrie, yes, the hymn of praise. This is the feast. Everybody sings the refrain. Women sing verses 1 and 3. Men sing verses 2 and 4. And that should be written out in the bulletin. We still have a couple of tickets left for Lock Media. We're going to see Godspell. That's this Thursday. We're leaving the church at 9 a.m. If you need tickets, let the office know and let Susan know. Carolyn will be starting her Bible study next Sunday, and we tried to do it. We tried an experiment. Well, what if we do it after church? Will people, come? Nobody did, so we're going to go back to doing it before church. She'd like to start it at 8:45. I think in the bulletin, the newsletter, it said 9 o'clock. But if we could start at 8:45, that gives you a full hour for the Bible study, and it's on 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and the letter of Jude. And this is the book, and books are here, and they're in the front office. So if you would like to come to that Bible study, just go into the office and grab a book on your way out, and then you can read ahead for chapter 1. This is in the book, it's a 12-week course. We're going to try to smush it into 8 weeks and just have one a lesson on each chapter. There's 5 verses in John 1, and then John 2 and John 3 and Jude are all just one chapter apiece. So it'll be an 8-week study. My Bible study, How Not to Read the Bible, that will be kicking off again this week as well. The materials aren't in yet, but I'm just going to copy off chapter 1 and pass it around. Chapter 1 is pretty much just an introduction to the whole series, so that'll be what we're doing Monday at 1:30 or Wednesday night at 6:45. So you can come to either one. We're asking people to sign up for Altar Guild. There's a sign-up sheet in the upper narthex. And lots of people have asked about John Gensimer. He is still at Mary Rattan. I talked to him Thursday, and he sounded pretty good. He has COVID. It's pretty bad. His sister said he was going in and out of lucidity. But when I talked to him, he seemed fine. I called the hospital today to make sure he was still there, and he is. And I let them know that since he doesn't have a phone, but there's a phone in his hospital room, that I will be talking to him at 1 o'clock this afternoon. So, hopefully. Prayers for John and for his sister and family. He really had it bad there for quite a while. It sounds like he's recovering, but he was in critical condition. So, a couple other people on the prayer list today, a couple of friends of mine, pastors that I know, Pastor John Schreiber and Pastor Karen Torres, are both facing surgery this week. John is having a kidney transplant, and Pastor Karen is having surgery on her knee replacement surgery. And then another pastor friend of mine, Pastor Robert Carter, passed away. He was the pastor he had been a pastor for 40 years. His most recent call was in Bodkins at St. Paul Lutheran. Please extend prayers to his family as he enters the church triumphant. Those are all the announcements we have, and we continue with, we don't have a prelude, right? No prelude.
Yeah, I have a prelude.
Oh, Judy has a prelude, we continue with
I'm prelude.
Okay. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your word.
We have turned our faces away from your word and have denied your as we expected. We have rejected your word and made us proud of ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those who call us to God.
Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
First reading is from Nehemiah. All the people of Israel gathered together into the square before the water gate. They told the scribe Ezra to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given to Israel. Accordingly, the priest Ezra brought the law before the assembly. Both men and women and all who could hear with understanding. This was the first day of the seventh month. He read from it, facing the square before the water gate, from early morning until midday, in the presence of the men and the women and those who could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people, and when he opened it, all the people stood up. Then Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. Then they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. So they read from the book from the law of God with interruption. They gave the sense so that the people could understand the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra, the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat, and drink sweet wine, and send portions of them to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The Lord, word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
second reading is from 1 Corinthians. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the ear would say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, and there being no dissension within the body, but the members must have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where this was written: The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, and he has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. I know we have a lot of teachers in this country. American literature, British literature, no? But you remember taking those classes, right? You remember being asked, if you read a novel, what is the theme of this book? What is the theme? I remember in high school I read The Great Gatsby. Now, Carolyn would say the theme of The Great Gatsby is that F. Scott Fitzgerald can write a very boring story and convince the world it's a classic, because it doesn't care very much. I think a theme of The Great Gatsby is that having wealth doesn't mean you'll automatically be accepted into upper class society, or another would be the familiar theme that money can't buy true love or happiness or contentment in life. Everybody in The Great Gatsby is wealthy, everybody in The Great Gatsby is miserable. Jay Gatsby pines for Daisy Buchanan, who once loved him but is now in a loveless marriage with Tom Buchanan. Tom's having an affair with Myrtle Wilson, who's in an unhappy marriage with George Wilson. Meanwhile, Nick Carraway, Daisy's cousin, is dating a women's golf pro, Jordan Baker, who seems distant and cynical about everything. Everyone in the Great Gatsby is wealthy, but nobody's happy. I think that's the theme, that money cannot bring you love or contentment. And if you were to ask me, what about the gospel? What is the theme of the Gospel of Luke? What is the theme of the Gospel of Luke? I would say this is it. This reading today, this is it. This is the theme of Luke's entire gospel, that Jesus has come to fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah. He is the anointed one, anointed by the Holy Spirit, which we saw at his baptism. Remember, the Hebrew word for anointed one is Messiah. Messiah means the anointed one. And in Greek, anointed one, the word for the anointed one is the Christ. The Christ is not Jesus' last name. I'm amazed at how many people think that. It's not Mary Christ and Joseph Christ and their son Jesus Christ. It's Jesus the Christ, the anointed one. The theme of Luke's gospel is that Jesus has come to bring good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captive, recovery of sight to the blind, let the oppressed go free, and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And all throughout Luke's gospel, this theme emerges again and again of reversal of fortune. How the mighty will be cast down and the lowly will be lifted up. Jesus is born poor to a poor couple and laid in a lowly manger, and poor shepherds are his first visitors. Mary sings of what her son will do in her Magnificat. Think of the great parables in Luke. The Bible has lots of parables, but Luke has more parables than any of the others. And many of the parables focus on this theme. And these are parables found only in Luke's gospel. The prodigal son, who squanders his father's inheritance and winds up hungry, feeding food to pigs in a time of famine. Yet his father welcomes him back with open arms, throws a party for him, and restores him to his former glory. There's the Good Samaritan, where a man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho is assaulted and robbed by bandits and left for dead. But a Samaritan, an enemy of his, saves his life, a parable that demonstrates how we are to care for our neighbor. And Luke is the only gospel that tells the story, the parable of the rich man and Lazarus, which we actually read in our confirmation class today. The poor beggar finds mercy and comfort in the afterlife, while the wealthy man who ignored him finds himself in a place of torment, not being punished because he is rich, but being punished because he did not live out the gospel and did not care for the neighbor. And Luke is the only gospel writer who tells the story of the thief on the cross, the penitent thief, whom Jesus forgives and invites into his kingdom. As we make our way through Luke's gospel in this coming liturgical year, this theme of reversal will be seen over and over again. But it leads to a disturbing question. Did Jesus come for me? Did Jesus come to save me? After all, I am not poor. I am not held in captivity. I am not blind, at least not physically. I am not oppressed. Indeed, I'm quite privileged. In fact, I hold every trump card in this society. I'm white. I'm male. Upper middle class. I'm straight. I'm cisgender. Am I one of the mighty ones who will be cast down from my throne? I'll come back. I'll come back. But I want to look for just a moment or two at the other readings today to show how they tie into that question. First, we have the Old Testament reading from Nehemiah. This is the only reading in the entire 3-year lectionary cycle where we read anything from Nehemiah, and the only time we encounter Ezra the priest. In our Bible, Ezra and Nehemiah are back to back, and they conclude the portion of the history of Israel. In the Jewish Bible, Ezra and Nehemiah are combined into one book. Nehemiah is a government leader, and Ezra is the priest. In this passage, the Israelites have returned from being exiled in Babylon. Persia has defeated Babylon, and the king of Persia, King Cyrus, has allowed the people to return to their homeland, even though they are still subjects of the Persian Empire. They have just finished rebuilding the temple that had been destroyed when Babylon invaded. And this is the first time that the people have gathered together to worship since the temple was rebuilt. And Ezra reads from the Law of Moses, the Torah, the first 5 books of the Bible, and the people weep. Why do they weep? Well, they weep because their beloved temple is rebuilt, but some weep because it's just not the same as it was before. But mostly, they weep because as they hear the law of God, they realize how far short they have fallen. They realize that they have turned their back on God and how this has led to their destruction and captivity. But the people are told, do not weep. They are told to celebrate and rejoice, for God has redeemed them from captivity in Babylon, just as he redeemed his people earlier from that bondage in Egypt. And he has redeemed them not because they deserve it, not because they were moral or decent people, but simply because they are God's people and God loves them. It is truly a beautiful passage, but it does lead to a very sad conclusion. At the end of the book of Nehemiah, the people commit themselves to following God's law. They repent and return to the Lord, but one of the ways they choose to do this is to completely isolate themselves from the rest of the world, from all foreigners, including if a man has married a foreign wife. Marriages were ended, and even the children, if they were foreign, were abandoned and outcast. It is disturbing to read, which is probably why we don't include it, because we don't know what to do with it. It's one of those passages that make non-Christians turn to us and say, is that what you believe? Why would you follow a God who tells his people to do that? But what I believe is that those people got it wrong, that God would not want a person to divorce a spouse simply because the spouse is of a different religion. And the theme of Luke's gospel refutes this idea. Luke's gospel refutes the idea that some people are in and some people are out. The New Testament rejects this claim, and Paul rejects it in his letter to the Corinthians. In fact, in today's New Testament lesson, we hear Paul say this, "For in the one Spirit we are baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we are all made to drink of one Spirit." And later we hear Paul say, "If one member suffers, all suffer with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it." Paul tells us that in Christ there is no longer hierarchy. When he says in Galatians, there's no longer Jew or Greek, no longer slave or free, no longer male or female, he's not saying there's no longer. What he's saying is there's no longer a hierarchy where one is better than the other. No longer is the Jew seen as superior to or better than the Gentile, or vice versa. No longer are men seen as superior to women. No longer are whites superior to non-whites, or the rich superior to the poor. poor, or natural-born citizen superior to immigrants, or straight superior to gay, or cisgender superior to transgender, those differences no longer matter. For we are still, while we are still a diverse body, we are all members of the body of Christ. And we all have unique gifts that lift up the body. We celebrate our diversity and understand that we all need each other. So yes, Jesus' mission frees and liberates me as well in two ways. First, history shows again and again, and Scripture confirms, when one of us is liberated, all of us are liberated. The abolition of slavery not only freed blacks, but also liberated whites, especially poor whites, who previously could not get jobs because slave labor had been available. And whites are liberated because they are no longer perpetrators of an evil institution. When women were given the right to vote, it expanded liberty for men as well, because it meant that politicians had to consider the will of all the people, not just men, and great female political leaders have emerged to help lead this country. So yes, good news for the poor is good news for the rich as well. For all of us are members of the body of Christ, and we rise and fall together. And of course, in a second way, all of us are captive. Captive to and oppressed by the forces of sin and death and the devil. And Christ liberates us all from these forces. All of us have experienced spiritual blindness, but Christ removes that blindness and allows us to see. And Christ comes into the world and does this and frees us and liberates us, not because we are good and decent or moral people who deserve being saved, but simply because God loves us and wants to redeem and save us solely by His grace. And this mission of Christ, I believe this is now the mission of Christ's church. This is our mission, at least until Christ returns. Next week, this gospel story will pick up right where the story leaves off today. And the people who are praising Jesus' words here will quickly turn against him when they truly realize what freedom in Christ means. So stay tuned for that next week. To God alone be the glory.
Let's confess our faith. faith in which we are baptized, using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of the church today, those having health issues, are John Ginsmer, Chris Tillman and her family. And for upcoming surgery, we have Pastor John Scriber, Pastor Karen Torres, and also with health issues is Todd Harbor and Chris Shannon. Those who entered the church triumphant are Reverend Bob Carter. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon you in abundance. So we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Teach us to love the intricate and beautiful bodies that you have created. Bless tiny insects, enormous whales, and every creature in between. Sustain species at risk of extinction. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
You desire that there be no dissension among us, where we are divided in our society, nation, or world. Come quickly to reunite us into the body. Ease conflict, dispel violence, and bring an end to war. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
Anoint us with your Spirit, all who seek your favor. Grant provision and justice for people living in poverty, people living in disability, those living with pain, and those living under oppression. We pray also for those who we now know are ill, hospitalized, awaiting surgery, or recovering, including John Ginsmer, John Shriver, Karen Torres, Chris Tillman and family, and Todd Harbor and Chris Shannon, and anyone else we now name either aloud or in silence. God of grace. Build up the body of Christ in this place. Bless the variety of ministries in this congregation. Bless us today as we vote in our new council members and on a ministry plan for 2022. Empower us to be freely blessed, welcome, and deeply value each person who enters into worship and ministry among us. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving, we lift before you the saints for whom the promise of salvation has now been fulfilled, including Reverend Bob Carter. Tend to those whom we mourn. Bring us together in your everlasting glory. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, at this time our attentions turn overseas to the Ukraine. We pray for that country. We pray for our leaders to have discussions so that they may avoid war in that part of the world. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you. In confidence and faith, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's hear the peace.
pray. Blessed are you, O God, sovereign of the universe. You offer us new beginnings and guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table, nourish us with the heavenly food, and prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ, our light.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
All means all, and God's gifts are free, so come to the banquet. All is ready. You may be seated. This is the body of Christ given for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. stand as your. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Send us to bring good news and proclaim your favor to all. Strengthen with the riches of your grace in your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you and calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in today and forever.
Amen.